To get your Bibles out and turn to the book of James this morning. The book of James is a book that speaks to us about maturity. It talks about troubles and trials, and it talks about joy. Matter of fact, the book begins by talking about joy, and it's going to talk about it all the way to the end. But the main theme of the book of James is maturity. And we as born-again believers need to grow up. None of us like working with somebody that we would categorize as immature. None of us do. Somebody who pouts, somebody who whines, somebody that always complains, somebody that always wants their way, we just get tired of it. And we make such statements that I wish they would just grow up. You know, it's like I have a friend and his statement is, just man up. Just be a man about it. Just grow up. This is life. This is the way it happens. Life is not always a bed of roses. James is the half-brother of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He describes himself as a slave of Jesus Christ, as a servant, but as a bond slave. He has freely given himself, surrendered himself to the possession of Jesus Christ. Jesus owns him, is James's statement at the very beginning of this book. Jesus, you own me, is what he's saying. I'm yours. James had grown up, and he's writing to the churches, he's writing to Christians, he's writing to you and I, and he's telling us that we need to grow up, that it's time that we quit wanting our way, our way, our way, and we start wanting God's way. So as we look at this book, we're going to try to go all the way through it. I want you to take your notes, and I want you to take time to pray over them during the week. Because James is a guy that gets in our face. He's a guy that speaks to the depths of our souls, and he reaches into our minds. He tries as he pulls at every nerve that we have. But he's simply trying to get us to grow up. He says, if you will look with me, the very first verse, he says, James, a bondservant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greetings. He mentions four things about maturity in these first 12 verses that we're going to try to cover this morning. And it's a challenge that James is issuing to us. And the first one is found in verse number 2. And it is the challenge of accepting the challenge to mature. Some people don't want to grow up. Some people want to, if they could, they would live that 12th grade of high school for the rest of their lives. They would play baseball, they would play football, they would cheerlead, they'd be on this team or that team, the debate team or whatever, the beta club. They would try to be class president, they would try to be homecoming queen, and they would just want to live that 12th grade year the rest of their lives. They go back and try to live it through their children's lives because they don't want to give it up. But there is a challenge for you and I. We must accept the challenge from God to grow up. He says in verse 2, my brethren, count it all joy. Now, we like those four words, but we don't like the rest of the verse. Count it all joy when you fall, he says, into various trials. Count it joy. We read that so quickly and we pass right over it and we just run on with our lives because we don't want to stop and hear what he's having to say. He said, count it joy. He didn't say just put on a fake smile. Yes, I'm glad to be here today, and I'm glad all of you came up. No, he's saying it's to be a joy that's down deep in our hearts, that when trials, troubles come our way, that we stand up and say, thank you, Lord, for the trials. We have the mistaken idea that if our Christian life is supposed to be a bed of roses and we never have a fever and we never have a broken fingernail, and if we're just walking with the Lord, nothing bad will ever happen to us. Well, I don't know where you got it from, but you didn't get it from the Bible. James says that trials are the way that God, your Father, uses to grow you up. And if you're going to mature, you're going to have to struggle in this life. That's not popular, is it? It's not. But that's what God says. God says, I made you. You rebelled against me, and the only way that I have learned to take you and make you into the image of Christ is to allow hardships to come into your life. That's the only way I'm able to mature you and grow you up. I wish there was another way, but there's not. Now, I'm hoping that you're stopping here for a moment and thinking, gosh, preacher, you just don't know what my troubles and trials are. I mean, just this week, you don't know what I've been through. No, I do not. But I want you to know that God is involved in every bit of it. God is involved in it. He is using it. He is using it to make you like Jesus Christ. It is the method that God uses. Now, we need to add a couple of scripture passages to this very beginning here, to kind of get us started. Because we're still running through our minds. No, preacher, if you have troubles in your life, it's because you got sin in your life. That's kind of the lie that we've been told. If you've got troubles in your life, it's because you're just a sinner. That's what they told Job. We need to go back and reread the book of Job and find out that Job was a righteous man. His troubles did not come because he had sin in his life. His troubles came because he was righteous. Maybe if you're not having any troubles, it tells us that you're walking hand in hand with the devil. That's kind of a hurting thing, isn't it? Let's go to John chapter 16 for just a moment. And you'll need to jot these down, because like I said, this is not just something for you to sit and listen to today and then run off to the house and never think about again. This is everyday living for us. In John chapter 16, if you go to the very end of the chapter, this is one of those chapters we love. This chapter talks about the Holy Spirit and sorrow turned into joy and all of those good things. And the disciples were not quite understanding what Jesus was saying. And he says, well, let me just talk very plainly to you. He says in verse 31, do you now believe? Indeed, the hour is coming. Yes, has now come that you will be scattered. He's looking at these guys and they just say, oh, Lord, we love you. We're going to walk with you every day of our life. And he says, listen, y'all are going to flee like a flock of chickens here pretty quick. Each to his own, and will leave me alone, and yet I am not alone because the Father is with me. He says, y'all are all going to desert me. Verse 33, these things I have spoken to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. In the world you have tribulation. Let that sink in just a moment. I have tribulation in this world. You have tribulation in this world. I don't get my way. You don't get your way. There's people, I don't know, this is hard for y'all to believe, but there's some folks that don't like me. It keeps me up at night. And there's some folks that don't like you. That may come as a shock to y'all, that there's somebody that doesn't like you. This world does not like you. Satan does not like you. He says, in the world you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer, he says. I love the last part. I, Jesus speaking of himself, have overcome the world. The world hates you. Speaking of sin, speaking of the devil, the kingdom of this, the prince of the power of the air, he doesn't like you at all. But Jesus said, you can have peace. I can sleep at night with peace in my heart because Jesus has overcome every enemy that I have. He's victorious over him. Now let's mark that one down. Write it in your bulletin. Mark it in your Bible. And then turn over right past the book of James to the book of 1 Peter. And look with me in the fourth chapter of the book of 1 Peter. Jesus says, you are going to have hardships in this life. It's a fact. Jesus said it. You're going to have it. 1 Peter chapter 4, and if you'll go with me down to the end of the chapter to verse number 12. Peter, you know, he's the guy that did it all. He's the guy that tried it all. And he's writing, and he says, beloved, so he's writing to believers, writing to you and I. He says, do not think it strange concerning, now listen to how he describes it, the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you, but rejoice to the extent you may partake of Christ's suffering. And you can read the rest of the verses for yourself. My friend, Satan is fighting against you. He is fighting you. He doesn't want you to succeed in your marriage, in your job, in your family, in raising your children. He doesn't want you to succeed in church. He doesn't want you to succeed in reaching your community. He doesn't want you to succeed in loving anybody. He wants you to fail. It is a fiery trial, Peter described it, that we are living in as Christians because Satan is our arch enemy and he wants nothing more than to destroy you. He wants to take everything you've got away from you. Now let's go back to James chapter 1 and verse 2. And good old James knows about these trials, fiery trials. He knows that there's tribulation in the world. And James raises his hands and says, let's just get excited and count it joy when we step into those fiery trials. Why, James, do we want to count it all joy? He's going to tell us in just a moment that it's a joy. But I want to keep coming back to this word joy because we just bypass it so quickly. The word count is the idea of evaluating something. We evaluate the value. What is the value of the things that you have? Your house, your car, your life, your job, those different things like that. There is a value to every bit of it. But James says, I want you to count the cost. Count it joy. Evaluate it and see the value of your relationship with Christ and see the joy. Jesus told us in chapter 16 of John, he would give us his peace. It's his peace. Let me give you another verse. You just jot this one down and I'll read it to you. In the book of Hebrews chapter 12 in verse 2, he tells us that when we are thinking about ourselves, he says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. Now listen to Christ. Who for the joy that was set before him, He counted it all joy. He endured the cross. Jesus counted it a joy to be nailed to the cross. Despising the shame, he was stripped naked. He was beat. He had a crown put upon him. He had his beard pulled out. He was to the point that people didn't even recognize who he was. Despising the shame, he was cast out as a Jew, you might say, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He said, it's my joy to go to the cross. It's my joy. He evaluated the value of him going through that suffering, and the value was that he saved your soul. He bought your life. He was able to give you eternal life. And he took a step back and he looked at that cross and he looked in your face and he said, you are worth every beating that I get, every crown of thorns that I wear, every bit of the punishment that I take. You are worth it. He evaluated you and said you were worth it for him to go to the cross and die in your place. And he stood up and said, I just go ahead and shout for a moment. And then he sat down at the Father's right hand. He counted it all joy. We need to count, to evaluate the benefits of our suffering, what God is going to make out of us, how he's going to change us from who we are with all of our faults and failures into people who look and act and talk and walk like Jesus Christ. Now, our values will determine for us how we evaluate something. What are our values? Now, if we value comfort, then we're going to say it's not worth it. That it's not worth it to go to church because the air conditioning, it never suits me. And the chairs never suit me, and the preaching doesn't suit me, and the music doesn't suit me, and there just ain't nothing there that suits me. So I'm concerned it's more comfortable at the house in my recliner watching my big screen TV, and I can watch whatever preacher I like, and if I don't like what he's saying, I can change the channel to another one. So if it's about comfort, or is your value about character? You're going to go one way or the other. You're either going to go for comfort, what suits me, or you're going to say it's about my character, about being a godly person, and I need to be about the business of God. You're either going to be a material person or a spiritual person. It's going to be about what you drive, what you're wearing, how you look, or it's going to be about the condition of your heart and what God sees when he looks in here. Our values, it's either about the present, I want it all right now, or it's about the future. I pour my life into these kids and what they're going to become and what these grandkids are going to become, the influence I am on them and the witness that I am on them. You see, it's a challenge that he gives to us, and we must accept it if we are going to mature. Are we willing to accept the challenge to grow up? We'll either accept it or we'll go out and be babes the rest of our lives. And we'll just be whiners and we'll be complainers. Now, go back, let's look at verse 2 and put it with verse 3. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, when everything at the house falls apart, everything at the job, everything in life, my health, you name it. Knowing this, verse 3, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience or endurance. Second of all, we need to acknowledge the challenge to mature. He says, verse 3, knowing, we need to acknowledge that this is the only way that I can become a person of patience. And patience is a courageous word. It speaks about perseverance. It speaks about looking the enemy in the eye and not backing down. Patience is a very courageous word in the Bible. He says that this is the way that God produces endurance or patience in my life. The testing of your faith produces endurance. It did it for Moses. It did it for Job. It did it for people throughout the Bible. Faith is always tested. God tests us in order to bring out the best that is within us. That's the way God gets it out of us. He puts us in the heat. And when we're in the midst of a trial, it's when we reveal what our true character really is. It's where the love comes out and the patience that comes out and the gentleness comes out. When we are tempted by Satan, Satan is seeking to bring out our worst. He wants us to come out cussing, and he wants us to come out fighting. He wants us to come out swinging. And so he tempts us in some way to lust and desire. But God tests our faith, our belief in him, in order that he may produce in us an endurance, a patience, a willingness, an ability to look our enemy in the eye and say no to him. James tells us here that this testing works for us. It works for us and not against us. The troubles that you're going through right now is not to tear you down, but it is to build you up. Trials are simply how we mature. If you're ever going to grow from where you are to be more like Jesus Christ, the only way you're going to get there is through trials in your life so that God can build endurance and perseverance and patience into your life so that godliness can be grown up within you and manifested, revealed. That's the only way. Now, you would love for God just to say, the way I'm going to mature you and make you a super saint is that I'm going to send you to a country where there's religious freedom just for you Christians, and and there's never a struggle, never a trial. Everybody agrees with you, and you just going to become a super saint. It wouldn't happen. And, it's like that the ice cream diet, that you just eat nothing but ice cream and you have, this perfect figure. It just doesn't work. It's a lie. It doesn't happen. And you can go sit on the top of a hill and hum for the rest of your life and shave your head and wear a woman's robe, but it's not going to make a super saint out of you. Where you're going to become a child of God that is a mature person is you're going to have to get down into the mud and the mire and walk in the hardships of life and let God show that he can take you through the war zone of life and bring you out on the other side, cut up and wounded, yes, but a person that reveals what Jesus Christ is really like. We must acknowledge the challenge to mature, or we will run from it the rest of our lives. Have you ever met anybody that at the age of 25 who had never picked up a baseball bat in their life, and all they did was, you put them out on the field and they were, they were a Hank Aaron? That kind of dates me, doesn't it? But you don't find that. You find that people become great athletes they start at the age of two or three, swinging a stick, swinging a bat, swinging a golf club, swinging a tennis racket, you name it. And they grow through the trials of failure, of doing it wrong and then doing it right, doing it wrong, doing it right, growing, and they become great athletes. People that become great cooks, they just didn't walk in the kitchen one day and turn on the stove and this, this wonderful banquet of a meal popped off the oven. They burned a lot of biscuits and a lot of cornbread and, messed up a lot of pots and pans and to get where they were. And then you need to stop and think about what you do for a living. Did you just pick up a book and read a couple of pages and boom, you got it all? Or have you walked through the trials of learning and struggling, of failure and success in your life, in your job? You see, it's through trials that we learn. They tell us we learn more by doing something wrong than we do by doing it right the first time. They tell us if we do something right the first time, that we will step back and in our minds ask ourselves, how in the world did I do that? And most of the time, we cannot repeat what we just did. It is a time of trial and error in our lives. It's where we go through the struggles of life. He tells us, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing this, that the testing of your faith produces patience, endurance. This is the way that it happens. You've got to be willing to accept the challenge to mature. God, I want to. I don't want to stay where I am. And you've got to acknowledge the challenge that it's going to be tough. It's not for sissies. It's not for people who want everything given to them. This is where real life happens. It's the Christian growing up into a mature Christian person, looking like Jesus Christ. Verse number 4 falls in here next. And it is the idea, let me read it, but let patience have its perfect work so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. God's desire is that you lack nothing in your Christian life. If I'm going to be that way, then I have got to allow the challenge to mature to happen. I can't fight against every trial that I face. I've got to know that it's coming and allow the struggle and let God walk me through it. Now, God does this for us, and there's some things that God does, and let me just mention them to you quickly. God does for us. What he does for us is salvation, justification, salvation. So that's not a work that we can do ourselves. We cannot save ourselves. So it is a work that God does for us. Now, God does something in us, and it's called sanctification. That's the process of him taking us from salvation and growing us in this physical body and making us more like Christ until he takes us home. So he does something for us. He does something in us. And then he does something through us, and it's called Christian service. It's what God does. This is where the Holy Spirit works in our lives, and he works through us, and we look like Jesus Christ. We act like Christ. We're not able to do that on our own. It's something that God, through his Holy Spirit, does through us. And James gives us an illustration here. And so if you would drop down to verses 9, 10, and 11. He says, let the lowly brother glory in his exaltation. Let that guy who has nothing, let him exalt, let him raise his hands and say, I thank God that I am born again and that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. And this world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. For my home is laid up somewhere beyond the blue. He says in verse 10, but let the rich man in his humiliation, because as a flower of the field he will pass away. For no sooner has the sun risen with a burning heat than it withers the grass, as its flower fails and its beauty, beautiful appearance perishes. So the rich man also will fade away in his pursuits. He says, let the rich man stand up and say, I thank God that my life is not made up of these things that I possess. They're just things that God has given me for me to use in this kingdom, but my relationship is with Jesus Christ. I am the same as the poor man. We are both walking with the Lord. And so he gives us this illustration of this growing up. What I have, if I don't have a dime in my pocket, It's God working in my life. If I've got millions, so what? It's still a relationship with the Lord. Those are mature thoughts, mature people. I'm not, you know, well, if I've got millions, then I'm better than the rest of you. I'm more spiritual than the rest of you, or something like that. No, James says a mature person sees the material stuff of this world as simply material and lays it aside. He sees that Jesus Christ is the greatest thing of their lives. He's growing people from immaturity to maturity here. Now, does that happen overnight? Well, no, it doesn't. For Joseph, it took 13 years, and most of that time was spent in prison. You preacher, you mean I could wind up in jail? In God growing me up as a Christian? Yeah, he has to put some people in jail. Because in jail is where they go through the trials that brings them from the place of coming to know Christ to growing up and maturing as a Christian. Joseph took him about 13 years, I believe, if you go back and look. It took Abraham, it took God working with him through trials and struggles 25 years before he would give him the promised son. It took him that long to mature Abraham to where he could be a decent father at the age of, what was it, 99, 100? 25 years. Moses, God, it took 80 years for God to get Moses to the place of maturity to where he could trust him to lead the children of Israel through the desert. 80 years it took. Trials and troubles and tribulations. Now, old Jonah, he never learned his lesson. God sent him to Nineveh. He refused to go. He got on a boat and they threw him overboard. A whale or a fish swallowed him up. He got sick on his stomach and spit Jonah out on the bank up there. Jonah went and preached and he sat down under a tree and all he could do was talk bad about the tree, talk bad about the sun, talk bad about the worm, and talk bad about God. That God had no business saving these Ninevites. He never did learn his lesson. We end the book of Jonah with a mad, pouting little boy sitting beside a dead bush. My friends, you can be a Jonah. And we can bury you with a frown on your face because you didn't get it your way. Or you can be a Joseph or an Abraham or a Moses. And you can walk with God through the trials of life. You can allow the trials to make you into a person that looks like Jesus Christ. It's up to you. It's your choice this morning. I'm not twisting your arm or forcing you to go either way. But it needs to come down to verse 5 so that we can put verse 5 and verse 12 together this morning. And we need to ask for the challenge to mature. And you're thinking, preacher, you're crazy. I'm not going to ask for hardship in my life. Then you're going to remain an infant, an immature person, and we'll have to put up with your immaturity the rest of our lives. Look at verse 5. He says, if any of you lacks wisdom. Well, preacher, I thought we were talking about maturity. Well, we are. And wisdom enables us to understand, listen to me, wisdom enables us to understand how God is using this trial and how we can benefit from it. We say, God, get me out of this struggle that I'm in. Wisdom says, God, show me how to use this struggle that I'm in. Show me with all that's fallen apart in my life, show me how to use it. He says in verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, then let him ask of God. God gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him, he says. God is wanting to give to us. We ask believing. We're going to ask in faith in verse 6. But God says, do you want to grow up? Do you want to mature? Do you want to walk with me? Do you want to be a spiritual person? A person that is filled with the Holy Spirit? A person that acts like Christ and talks like Christ? Do you want that? Then ask for it. You're asking for wisdom to be able to look at your life and understand how to use it in God's economy for God to mature you and make a godly person out of you. Now let's follow along because we've got a couple of verses here to put together. Now when you're asking, he says, but let him ask in faith. That means believing. I asked some of them this morning, do you believe that God wants to heal you? I mean, if you're coming not believing, then we're kind of wasting our time, aren't we? Let him ask in faith with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind, like a cork on the wave, just bobbling along, going every which way the wind blows him. For let not that man suppose, that's an immature man, let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He won't. He is a double-minded man. He is unstable in all of his ways. Now, God will give you the wisdom to know what to do with your trial if you'll ask him. Now, if you think I'll just figure this out on my own and I'll get out of it myself, then you're going to be there for a while. But God rewards us by us enduring our trials and learning from them and becoming more like Christ. We're rewarded with Christ's likeness. You know all that's being filled with the Spirit, that love, joy, peace, that goodness, gentleness, long-suffering, self-control, all of that kind of stuff. He pours it into our lives. Now, James makes a very clear statement here in verse number 8. Because he tells us that a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Somebody that's all for the Lord one minute, and the next minute they're right out there shoulder to shoulder with the devil. And you and I have met those people. And we're talking about just in church we've met those kind of people. They were just wishy-washy. They were never just set. In the fourth chapter of James, he makes this statement down at verse 7 and 8. He says, therefore submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Verse 8, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts. And what does he say? You double-minded. We're still in the same book. He tells us over here that let not that man suppose he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all of his ways. And he's talking about asking in faith about believing. The word purify or purity in the fourth chapter is a word that has to do with a relationship. And it speaks about a partner, a husband, a wife. And it speaks about somebody who is faithful as opposed to somebody who is unfaithful. Now, it's hurtful to have an unfaithful partner. A spouse that goes and has a relationship with someone else. Double-minded, unstable, unfaithful, impure. All of those terms come together. James is being very blunt here. And he is telling you and I as Christians that when we are not willing to embrace our trials and ask God to show us what He wants to do with those trials and what He's wanting to do in our lives and how He's wanting to make us more like Christ, help me to understand what you're doing. When we refuse to do that, but we step over to the side and we whine and gripe and complain, and all we pray is, God, get rid of him, get rid of her, you know, just change my situation, move me to another country, that we are being double-minded, unstable in all of our ways. We are being an unfaithful lover. We're being unfaithful to God. That's a very blunt picture. I mean, that slaps you in the face for God to say, you're being unfaithful to me. Oh, God, I'd never be unfaithful to you. God says, well, that's what it is. I'm trying to mature you. I'm trying to do the very best for you. And you're running off and trying to find happiness in material things, in vacations, and theme parks, and new furniture, and new cars, and new whatever. You're trying to find happiness and joy in things of the world. You're being an unfaithful lover to me, God says. Now that hits home for us. James says we need to ask for maturity. God, take me through whatever trial you need to take me through to cleanse the filth out of my life and to enable me to love you more than anything else. We're going to find in the book of James that he's going to lead us to the center point that it's all about loving Jesus Christ. And our problem is we don't. When we get over to the book of 1 Corinthians and we talk about it, get into chapter 12 and so forth, you get into all of these gifts that we have. And buddy, we clamor after those gifts. And then we get to chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians and Paul kind of clears his throat and he says, yes, all of those are great things, preaching the gospel, prophesying, evangelizing, speaking in tongues, healings, you name it. He said, but let me tell you, the greatest thing of all is love. Is love. James is going to tell us the exact same thing in his book. As mature Christians, we love the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus would say we need to love him with all of our heart, soul, and mind, and our strength, and then we'd be able to love our neighbors ourselves. James is saying what you and I have is that we have a love problem, that we are unfaithful lovers. We're trying to love Jesus Christ, and we're trying to love something over here. And we're just a cork bobbling on the waves. And the reason that we have no peace and no joy in our lives is because we are unfaithful lovers. I heard about a lady, and her husband was in the hospital. He was at death's door. During the process, she went through a stroke. Her boss was at the hospital visiting her, and there she sat in the chair, unable to move one arm, holding on to her husband's hand as he was taking his last breath. And he said to her, his employee, he said, I want you to know that I'm praying for you. And she startled him, and she said, what are you asking God for? And he said, I was caught off guard, kind of. And he said, well, I'm asking God to give you strength for what you're going through. And she said, would you ask God to help me to understand how not to waste this situation that I'm in right now? He said, God had to bring me back to James chapter 1 before I could understand what that woman was asking of me. She was wanting the wisdom. She was asking God for wisdom to know how to get the most to get everything out of that bad situation, she used the words. He said, it haunted me. I don't want to waste this trial that I'm going through. That haunts me. How many of the trials in my life have I wasted? I could be closer with Christ today than what I am, but I wasted my trials that I went through. Those hardships, those times where I didn't think God was fair, when I didn't think the world treated me right, when I didn't think anybody was treating me right. How many of my trials have I wasted? Pure out wasted. Because I refuse to ask God for the wisdom to understand how to use my hardship, my trial. I want to say to you this morning, I want to impress upon you. I don't want you to waste your trials either. Now, you may be saying, preacher, don't pray any of that James stuff for me now. Just let me get out the door, and I may not be back. But as your pastor, I'm praying for myself and for our church. And since you are the church, I'm asking that we not waste any trial that God is passing us through. Remember what Jesus said. He had overcome the world. Our Savior is greater than our trial. So our trial is not to kill us. Our trial is to mature us, to make us just like Jesus Christ. So my invitation to you this morning is this. What is your trial that you're facing right now? Get it fixed in your mind. And I want to invite you to just get up out of your seat and bring it to this altar and ask God, God, don't let me waste this trial.